You know, in retrospect, it's amazing that we allowed ourselves to think that processes that happen in the cell that involve many different components that need to get together, that that would occur by random chance, and that we'd have enough molecules of each type that they would randomly come and associate with one another.
I for sure didn't know that different genes were in contact with each other in a liquid droplets, in a liquid compartment where transcription was happening.
There were questions the students would ask us that we couldn't answer. And at some point we began to think, maybe there isn't an answer today because we've been thinking about the problem all wrong.
I've always been fascinated by how dozens of protein and RNA molecules need to come together at the right place at the right time in the nucleus to activate particular genes. And the reason why this is so important for it to happen with high fidelity is because every process in your body requires that the right genes be turned on at the right time. And any errors in this process can cause diseases like cancer and many others.
The standard model of gene regulation says that a DNA region called an enhancer attracts a transcription factor, and that the transcription factor then recruits the apparatus to transcribe a gene in a series of one-to-one interactions. But that model wasn't a full explanation. How did all of these parts find each other in the cell?
The old model was failing to describe these new observations that people were making.
New higher resolution microscopes allowed researchers to see that there were places in the nucleus where transcription machinery was highly concentrated. The young lab began to wonder if this new information could help them understand special DNA regions they were studying called superenhancers.
There were really clusters of enhancers that were associated with genes that are playing some of the most prominent roles in cell identity.
The genes that turn a cell into a part of skin tissue or heart muscle. And in cancer cells, superenhancer regions were leading to uncontrolled growth. When the young lab examined the superenhancer regions, they found all the necessary transcription proteins concentrated at these key cell identity genes, right where they were needed most, not randomly dispersed.
When you consider that the cell in the nucleus is an incredibly crowded environment, right, it became very interesting to understand how, for special genes at least, you might form some specialized compartments or some kind of organelle.
In 2017, Young and colleagues proposed a new model. It said that organelles without membranes concentrate transcription machinery for highly efficient expression at superenhancer DNA regions.
Ben Sabari and Alessandra Dall’Agnese and many of their colleagues in the lab abandoned many of the projects they were working on to go and explore this model. They did some extraordinary risk-taking in imported into the lab many technologies we did not have, and began to study this possibility.
The researchers first tested to see if regulatory proteins called coactivators formed droplets within cells.
You can color the cells by immunofluorescence, and if the droplets are formed, you should see puncta present in the nucleus, regions of high intensity of the color.
The team successfully saw the droplets forming in live cells. The next step was taking a closer look in a test tube.
We purified these proteins, we put them in the test tubes, and what we found is that they form spheres that have liquid properties. They look like the big balls in the lava lamp. And now all of a sudden you can see how you can concentrate so many factors and to make sure that transcription occur in an efficient way.
Remarkably, every experiment they did came back with results consistent with the model we had proposed. But more importantly, they built on that idea. Now, you're not relying just on random chance meeting of these molecules, but you're actually creating a structure within which you can operate with many different components at much higher concentrations that are very different than if you were just assembling things at random.
But big questions remained.
What we didn't know is what leads to the formation of these droplets. And there are these proteins called transcription factors. They are the ones that recognize the position on the DNA where the droplets have to be formed.
It has two domains, a DNA binding domain, which can find a site in the genome where it needs to operate, and another domain that's responsible for communicating with the transcription apparatus.
The team needed to figure out how the activation domain worked, but its structure was highly flexible and hard to characterize.
That mystery, people tried to solve with all kinds of hand-waving arguments. And so when Anne and Isaac came up with the idea that the reason transcription factors have an activation domain that doesn't form a stable structure is that's an important component of their function.
What the science paper nicely described was how the co-activators form these droplets to activate genes, but we didn't know how they were forming at specific sites. So the transcription factor will provide sequence specificity and direct where the co-activator will bind and form these condensates. And we also know that these disordered regions are a driving force of condensate formation, and the transcription factors have this activation domain that have that property.
Activation domains are disordered. So when a new concept comes around explaining how this thing works that we know is critically important but we've never really understood how it functions, our first thought was very simply, can we put these two concepts together and understand something about this disordered activation domain using this new concept? And it turns out we can.
The researchers took the transcription factor's activation domains out of cells to see how they would interact with a second regulatory protein called a coactivator.
So they're forming these round spherical droplets that settle on the glass and they can fuse together to form these condensates. It's amazing. They are like so beautiful, they're forming pearls, and it's real fascinating.
Counterintuitively, the activation domain's lack of a stable structure is what lets them do their job.
Yet they're sort of shaped like noodles is sort of the best way to think about them. And you know, noodles are wobbly and they don't have one particular shape that they conform to. So what you get is a bowl of noodles instead of two fixed shapes interacting with one another. And that bowl of noodles is what we think about as a condensate.
Can also very tightly link the formation of the condensate to a gene activation. So every time we mutated a residue that perturbs the condensate, we can also see a loss of gene activation.
The researchers showed that the droplets formed along strands of DNA, looking like pearls on a string, to boost the expression of key genes. Knowing how these droplets form and control gene expression opens up an exciting new pathway to explore treatments for diseases in which gene control goes awry, cancer.
I think it's revolutionary. It's just putting a totally new framework on how we look at gene regulation. And that can open up a whole new world of therapeutic benefits, for example, because one of the hallmarks of cancer is dysregulated gene activation.
Just the idea that there's a new way of understanding how these proteins and how these processes are working, or if we're lucky, a lever to pull in actually drugging them and turning them on and off, is an extremely exciting proposition for someone who, you know, spends a lot of their time looking at people who really need new treatments for their cancers, and those treatments are not going to be found by looking in the old places.
Understanding these droplets offers a window into how cells make decisions and modify themselves very efficiently.
So you can imagine if you have this kind of S-curve and you're sort of changing a variable on the x-axis, you can just put some very small amount of input in and you get a very dramatic change.
While this property of droplets helps give a cell its identity, it can also let it rapidly mutate that identity and become a cancer cell.
But it's also very appealing then if we could push it just a little bit backwards, it could fall off the cliff and we could modulate these types of genes.
And so if we know how they are formed and we know the cancer cells form in position where they are not supposed to be, we can target them and destroy these liquid droplets where they are not supposed to be. And now all of a sudden the cancer cell will stop being a cancer cell.
Well, one question I get fairly frequently is, to what extent is the formation of condensates a property of just a few things in the cell, and most of the rest of the cell just operates the way we've always thought? So far, the track record of studying a new protein and finding that it's in a condensate is 100%. So we're beginning to wonder if, in fact, all of what the cell does is controlled in this context of membrane-less organelles that operate by these properties. So I don't know that that's true, but it strikes me as a brave new world where the possibilities for uncovering how biology works and how it is dysregulated in disease are endless. Now, I find that enormously exciting.